that we'll have discussion with the board and audience members. Dr. Coleman?
I think perhaps I would ask Peter to move on this. You want these numbers planted?
I'll go sit over here.
I'm going to deal with that. Do you need the mic? Does it need the mic? Well, good evening. Another budget cycle has rolled around. And one of the first lessons I think I ever learned as a superintendent during my first year as a superintendent was the power of using a budget to try to think of the system as a whole. Because even though it is a document made up of literally thousands of pieces of information, there really is a pattern to it. Those of you who've been on the board for a number of years certainly know that what that pattern is and how it changes from year to year, but how there's the basic pattern remains. And those of you who are relatively new to this process have an opportunity to ask all the questions you wanted to ask and get maybe down at the bottom of the answers. I'm going to start this evening by showing an overview, and I understand this is being taped and will be viewed at some point for the community. I don't know how visible all of those numbers are. Perhaps we can make that a little sharper. Well, I think that may be as sharp as we can get it, and I'll run down through so that an audience can deal with this. And there are, I want to start by saying that we have copies of the budget available for the general public, as well as, of course, the board, and we'll be distributing it in various ways. But there are copies in my office, and anybody who wants to may stop by and get it. Also, all of our budget workshops are televised, and they are essentially clustered around cost centers, which in our system is mainly, of course, the individual schools, although we also have a system-wide cost center, and we talk about things like debt service and consulting services and so on in the general system-wide accounts. However, last year, you may recall that we, in fact, initiated a budget computer program that allowed us to pull out on one sheet a very powerful summary. And that's what I'm going to start and end my presentation with. So if it all looks sort of overwhelming right now, don't worry about it. We'll come back to it. Those of you who have your budget can simply follow along through. But I want to call attention to what this summary really does. You'll notice at the top that the people costs of the school district are by far our heaviest single piece of the budget. So that much of what we talk about in budgeting is how many people do we have, do we need new positions, can we get by with fewer positions, obviously salary discussions and so forth are very powerful when we look at this total number. Under that you have a list of different things in addition to salaries and benefits. We have other items. We do have things like substitute accounts, consultants. And consultants, by the way, fulfill a number of things. That is, people who are not on formal contract with us as staff members, but people who may do some analysis, diagnosis, or short-term things, particularly in special education, or for we have a drug education program and so forth. We also, under stipends, co-curricular, et cetera, athletic stipends, have a number of specific negotiated sums of money that are paid to our teachers or outside personnel who come in and run those programs for us. In addition, the supply account, I think it's always interesting for people to notice that supplies are not a large part of our budget. Again, I'm going to leave that alone. I may make it worse. It looks fuzzy to me, and I don't know if it's my... It is fuzzy. All right. It's a 9% for this year, up... a 6% total budget, up 9%, but as we go through the budget, you'll see that that is just about a $50,000 increase, and we're talking about specific pieces of equipment, building costs, the transportation, food service, fringe benefits, debt service, and the contingency account that we carried last year and that we will continue to try to carry in this year's budget. So that roughly 75% or 72% of our budget in total salaries and 27% in all others. I certainly want to call your attention tonight to the fact that the total budget is only up 2.21%. That is in actual dollars from last year's budget, the one that we've been operating on. Whatever our needs are, you will have a better picture of those as we go through our general discussions. That really, frankly, I feel that the entire staff, administration, and teaching staff who have discussed all of these issues deserve real credit for trying to keep that target. However, I have to point out that cheerful as, from a taxpayer point of view, that kind of increase sounds, I really, in all honesty, must point out that there are some question marks in presenting a budget at this time. One of the major question marks is the fact that we, frankly, depend to a fairly generous amount on state subsidy, about 29% of the budget, as far as the way the state figures the budget, comes from state subsidy. It's not 29% of our total budget, but it's technically known as a 29% subsidy. And without that money, we would have a much bigger impact on the local tax rate. You're all aware that we lost subsidy this year, that is after we had an adopted budget last year, with the $2,077,549 figure that you see in the left-hand column. That was our approved state revenue subsidy formula figure for last year. Now, as we tried to build a budget this year, we knew that we were not likely to get that full figure, even though originally the legislative branch talked about a flat funding. Since we lost the money this year and we hear rumors like everybody else about what's going to happen with the upcoming budget, frankly, we took a figure for subsidy that reflects the loss of subsidy from this year, plus an additional small amount, which is just a guesstimate. We don't actually know how much subsidy we're going to receive. Normally, the state sends us a subsidy printout in December. We have not received it yet. We have received notification from the commissioner's office that they'd like to send it, but that the normal process has not been completed. It is a process that has to go through the governor's office and the legislative branch, and they haven't been able to set a figure. So this is our best guess. If it's right and we're a little low, then we will receive more money than this. If it's wrong and we're a little high, then we have an additional impact on our budget. We think it's a reasonable guess. We are projecting that since the weather has been relatively mild, we haven't burned as much oil as we sometimes do, and the price has held steady. Even though we had to cut back on a number of things, we think we may, in fact, have a small balance at the end of the year. So we're projecting about a $35,000 balance. We have had some money from energy grants in the past. We know we aren't going to, the state isn't going to have that program this year. And therefore, you have a subtotal of total revenues before local. Other miscellaneous local revenues, frankly, that's mostly from our nursery school kindergarten, pre-kindergarten program, which basically covers the cost of that program, so that's basically a wash. However, we must add it as revenue. The other important source of revenue, of course, for us is from local property taxes, approximately 8% of the budget, and so the total local revenues together with the total state revenues add up to our full budget. We are projecting a 9.4 budget, and the information at the bottom of this sheet indicates how we estimate what the impact on the tax rate would be from this budget, taking the town valuation, the school budget assessment, the mills raised for school support. It would budget just as it stands, presuming that we were to hold steady with the the, again, the major reason why we can have a budget that's only up 2%, but impact the local tax rate at 4% is strictly a factor of loss of state revenue. Now, in your packets, you have some features. I'm going to pull out just a few tonight because all of these details will be covered by individual principals and building reviews.
Would you like us to play with that again and see if we can get it?
Why don't you? I would appreciate it.
It can't get any worse. So.
No, I know.
But we say that.
Is it supposed to be used in a classroom, I suppose? One of the, in a tight budget year like this, have to deal with extraordinary expenses, unusual expenses, is a real challenge. And since we've already spent many hours looking at space needs, space problems, we've already taken a vote on moving the kindergarten to the high school, which also a move which will bring the fourth grade back into Pond Cove, and there are a number of associated issues that we have discussed. I thought it would be helpful at this point to point out that the budget does provide for that move. Now, these figures are not absolute hard figures. I'm still getting some figures back from the architect, the design architect who's working with us on the actual renovations, but they are pretty good approximations. Obviously, something may cost less, and another piece of the project may cost more, but we have estimated at about $200,000, and I would just like to run down through those to indicate how widespread this kind of reorganization for use of space really is. First of all, there are renovations of the current math wing in the high school to make those rooms appropriate for kindergarten. Those are pretty self-explanatory. There'll be some additional bathroom work, classroom sinks, carpeting, the new entrance exit, which we were talking about, to meet fire code for children that age, and miscellaneous kinds of things to work within the classrooms themselves. But there's also impact on the high school. In order to maximize the use of space at the high school, not only for the kindergarten move, but also for the additional numbers of youngsters that will start coming into the facility next year. In the times when the facility has had only a few hundred students in it, things have gotten pretty spread out. But as we plan for more kids in the building, we have to be a little more efficient about how we organize things. Moving the nurse's office is a function of the kindergartners using that wing, but moving the dark room and current art facilities, for instance, is more a factor of consolidating certain uses of space, particularly for the art facility. We also know we're going to have a need for some playground equipment, for fencing, for cabinets, movable furniture, tied to particularly the kindergarten use. I don't have a particularly strong figure there, but I have had some conversations with community services about playground equipment. We may work out a combined funding effort there. That's why that figure is about where it is. And for the move that actually impacts directly Pond Cove, that is move of fourth grade and some additional moving of staff uses inside that building, it is necessary for us to think ahead about extra pieces we may need or some possible modifications of room there. And I also put a little money in here because as we relocate the kindergarten and the fourth grade, we may need, for instance, one extra period for art or music or a gym. And at this point, we don't know that exactly. Our staffing is still being worked out, but I put a little money there to cover that contingency. So that all adds up to the $200,000. It sounds like an overwhelming figure just to move kindergarten from the Pond Cove to the high school, but it isn't all focused at the kindergarten level. As you can see, it's a matter, really I think it's better seen in the sense of reorganizing use of space. The second feature of this budget, last year we talked a lot about the need to take a good look at what we were doing and see if there was some way we could refocus or downsize some of our programs. Because again, remember that 73% of our budget is targeted on our own staff salaries and another 4 or 5% targeted on consultant fees and so forth, so that over 80% of our budget are really people costs. So anytime we talk about having to meet budget stringencies, we are certainly talking about people, no question about it. In this particular budget, I am making some recommendations. These have been discussed administratively, and they have been discussed with the teachers that are in the departments that are likely to be affected. But as, just want to remind everybody that when we talk about proposed cuts, they are at this point only proposed cuts. The final decision is the board's, and it is part of your budget review to agree with our recommendations or not to agree with them, but here they are. The first items you see there are really tied to the number of students we have in individual elementary classrooms, and those are still, frankly, being discussed and evaluated as to exactly what grades ought to have exactly what divisions. The number of classroom divisions talks about what teachers would be involved, and when Beth Henderson makes her presentation, she'll go into more detail. It's, however, our opinion that given the enrollments that we are projecting, that we can cover needs in two classrooms by downsizing to other grades. And we will show you what the exact enrollments are so that you have some understanding of what impact that might have on next year's class size. I believe the board 3 years ago instituted, or possibly at that point it was an enlarging of an existing position, I'm not sure which, but at the 4-5 level, a gifted and talented teacher, and certainly that's been a program that we've tried a variety of approaches to. At this point, I am recommending that we consider cutting the position. I do want to point out that I have put a small amount in the consultant line so that we can continue to offer services to the what the state calls the 5% of identified gifted that we certainly have. Even I don't know exactly what the so-called mandates are on gifted and talented right now, but regardless of mandates, there is always some need for dealing with children who have a particularly strong talent in some particular area. And so we're not talking about eliminating gifted and talented services. We're talking about eliminating that as a staff position and downsizing the services. I also point out that the effort to upgrade standards, particularly in the math program and our current review through curriculum on system-wide, it is so clear from the discussions we've had with the community that parents in general want us to consider higher standards, more achievement for all children, and in a sense broadening the base, a general part of that gifted and talented program. Last year, the integrated arts program was downsized, and we are continuing that process. Again, Beth Henderson will be explaining some specifics of that. At this point, and in this list at least, we are eliminating an aid that was attached to that program. I should also point out that about $20,000 additional from that program has been cut from the or from the visiting artist side, and again, you will have a specific proposal on that to spell out what's left. At the middle school, 6th through 8th grade, we have a situation here where a large 5th grade is moving to the 6th grade, and the current 8th grade moving to the high school is the last of the approximately 100 pupil classes that we have left. So that at both the 6th and the 8th grade next year, the middle school will have to cope with considerable increases in numbers. Therefore, we are adding two teachers, one at the 6th grade, one at the 8th grade, upping the hours of the teacher aide, and we will need another half-time special ed teacher to cope with the numbers that we project moving into that particular stream at the grade level. We are, however, at this point recommending, after a good deal of review, that we cut the half-time life skills program. We looked at the possibility of picking up the health education aspects of that and putting them in other programs. We don't have absolute answers to that, but we are satisfied that we can do that. In this section, we have listed custodial staff. It doesn't necessarily belong here. It could just as well be in a system-wide line, but and I will immediately follow that up with the rest of the cuts, objective or additions. You'll notice in, under system-wide bus drivers with the notation reorganized, both that custodial and bus driver position anticipate being absorbed through attrition, but I think it's really important to point out that we are reorganizing our services there. We are looking at a variety of ways in which we can take advantage of the system-wide computerized approach to use of buildings that has been developed to a high degree of efficiency at community services, and I will be discussing in more detail when we review the community services budget how I believe we can expand some of their known expertise to cover at least some of the management side of the custodial and transportation services. We don't have anything budgeted for that reorganization. It is our belief that we will save some money, which will fund any of the additional pieces that we might need to accomplish that. So we are going on that assumption. We have looked at our high school and decided that there could be some changes as far as the secretarial staff. We had again, that would be accomplished through attrition. We had a secretary leave this year. We filled that position for the rest of the year on a short-term basis only. Therefore, what we would be having is simply dropping that position at the end of this year and reorganizing space and assignments of the remaining secretarial staff. We have had to pick up from the certification grants some that was going to the time that Mary Brunt spends working on certification. That was a cut that's actually part of the subsidy cut when we're showing it there. And I have decided to actually add on to the list. My secretary's been working 42 hours a week, and we feel that it's best to be really straightforward with this, and I'm coming to you with a request to say, let's pay the lady what she's working. Right now she's working on supposedly 37 and a half hour week. I've never seen her work 37 and a half, and I think it's about time we start paying her. It's not an increase. I'm not requesting for my secretary an increase in her position. I merely want to see justice done. The net result of those additions and deletion actually is a decrease. And if you add to that the $20,000 that we've already decreased from the Artists in Residence program, you really have a decrease of $40,000 to $45,000. Again, that's continuing the trend that we started last year to try to look for ways in which we can trim, consolidate, and reorganize rather than eliminate programs, although in some cases, frankly, that is what is happening. This is a summary to try to tell you where we think, how can we do this? I mean, are we somehow cheating ourselves, our staff, and our students, most importantly, by trying to be so cost-effective? We believe that we have a time when creative solutions to budget problems are required. In reorganization, backing off and looking at the resources we have, is there some way that we can use them for the goals that we've identified for ourselves and the community has identified? So much of what we're hearing from the community this year in our community dialogues and in our parent questionnaires that are coming back to us and individual committee work is to focus on those areas that are going to be most important for children's lifelong learning. There is no question that the community wants to support rigorous, important, re-evaluated standards of learning, and these are at least some of the ways in which we're trying to do that. We're reorganizing our thinking about gifted and talented. Not saying that that's not important, but just how do we do it? We think that we can take, for instance, under elementary math and language arts coordination, for a number of years had teachers who were half-time and half-time working with their peers in a curriculum coordination position. We are reassigning those teachers to full-time classroom use, and we have, in fact, however, looked at we will be looking at some use of the their time or some other staff person's time to pick up small pieces and, for instance, add individual gifted and talented math class. That is a way in which we would prefer to deal with it. We also, I ought to jump down here to number five, the transition of career ladder merit pay to specific job descriptions. One of those specific job descriptions that is being recommended teacher leadership position in curriculum, where a specific kind of curriculum leadership is identified, somebody applies for, and it's a year-to-year position. It does not become a quasi-administrative position. It's a teacher leadership focused directly on some specific curriculum issue. So we are not totally losing the spirit of the teacher resource person. We are coming at it from a somewhat different point of view. Also, I might add, broadening the base. I mentioned the reorganization and transportation custodial services. We'll be looking at that mainly from an efficiency of management services, trying to take advantage of our centralized computer ways of looking at assigning people through community services. I'm particularly interested in the trend I see coming from all three librarians on technology, trying to really teach children how to use some technology. Right now we have some of that in the high school library. You'll see in the budget review we're asking for a few additional pieces. At the moment, we cannot deal with redoing all of our technology facilities, although the high school has a specific proposal that we'll describe later this evening. But I want to call that one to your attention. It is possible to teach a lot of kids how to do database work through the libraries, and I think that's a very cost-effective way to target some of the increases that we need to do. We'll need to be aware of those issues. We've already talked a little bit about space needs met by using available high school rooms. This is all part of reorganization. We have clearly tried to look at the resources we have and figure out what is the best way we can use them. And I want to point out to you an issue that you have not discussed yet. Most of these things you've discussed in one way or the other. We will be looking at the calendar before too long for next year. And I've certainly had a lot of conversations with individual parents and some board members about the whole issue of released afternoons. Certainly, all of us are aware that a longer school year would be a very attractive way for us to emphasize how important education is. In the kind of budget we're facing, particularly since we're still transitioning out of the career ladder, and we have some needs to consider in our upcoming negotiations, it does not seem possible for us to have a budget where we can actually fund additional days at this point. However, we're looking for what do we have that we can work with, and I have put a $15,000 figure in this budget to add to our substitute account, and we have at least the outlines of a proposal to extend student work days by reducing these afternoons. That is not a firm proposal with all the details worked out. I've asked administrators to discuss that with teachers. Some staffs feel more strongly than other staffs about the value of released afternoons. I'm not saying that I think that staff development or teaching workshop days are not important. I think they are important, but I'm looking for ways in which we might be able to plan for systematically covering classrooms with trained substitutes, trained specifically for that assignment, so that we could get small groups of teachers together to do the planning that they now try to do, at least on the released afternoons. I think that is another example of looking for reorganization. And in closing, I just want to point out a couple of things. As you go through a budget with the number of lines that we have in this budget, you're going to find several issues that either look, percentages look out of whack, or there's something that surprises you, or that may even seem inconsistent with something that I just said. Some of those are just plain glitches, and as we go through, obviously, we will be correcting those and catching up with them. But some of them are the vagaries of budgeting, and I've had a couple of questions about them, so I'll point them at you now, and as we go through, we can find all the others. The administrators' lines show an increase in salary that is not accurate. The figure is accurate, but what it is that budgets are built so that you can compare one year to another. And last year, when the budget was put together, the board had not agreed to a specific sum for each administrator. And so the figure that's in there is basically the figure that was in last year's budget at this time, which was later adjusted when the contract was signed. We'll be correcting those as we go along elementary coordinators to classroom assignments. Well, why are they still in the budget? They're in the budget because that's the way your budget is right now. And as we phase out those particular departments, the year-to-year comparisons will also be phased out. It does not mean that that's a continuation. It simply is that, that's, you know, we can make the decision, okay, we all understand that, and we'll just put those monies back into both the staffing and supply line, and we can rerun that part of the budget, and if people feel that that's what they want to do, fine. But the typical way of doing it would be to say, okay, that's what was budgeted in that department last year, and this is what's budgeted this year, and in 2 years it disappears. But that's why that's in there, not because there's any inconsistency with what I just said. As we go through then, I hope not only you, but also anybody who watches these sessions or chooses to come, will feel free to ask questions. That's exactly what budget workshops are for. They are intended not only to explain requests, but also to help people understand what are those monies used for. Frankly, the computer program we're now working with is really sophisticated. We can do projections, we can do summaries, we can, and as we get better at it, we can be as clear as possible. It's our intention to be clear. We won't always have an instant answer because there is a great deal of detail behind all of these budget lines. But we really look forward to explaining them, giving you our sense of how this budget connects to our vision of what we wanted to do. And I just hope we get a little more money from the state so that our problems will be as manageable as possible. Thank you.
An overall summary for you on the first page, and you can see what additions or changes there have been in each of the department budgets. There are really three departments that have substantial increases in their budgets. Other than that, most of the budgets are down. Those are business, mathematics, and science. But I'll go through them all briefly. The summary of the instruction expenses really is a compilation of all the instructional expenses in the department budget. So that first, the top part of page two is exactly what is in the budget that we all received earlier in the week on the Macintosh. D. I guess it's page 14 in the proposed budget that the school district gave. And then we just simply start with each department. The high school budget is compiled in December by department heads, administration, some students who are members of the SAC. We meet as a committee, go over the budget. This year there was relatively little discussion because people simply brought in budgets that were I think very spare, very much, I think, responsibly built, and we have adequate funding for programs, but there's really not the same problems that we had last year when we were trying to cut substantial amounts of money out of our budgets because we had a funding crunch. This year, people came in right from the beginning with a very modest set of requests. In business, there is a substantial increase. Business department is requesting 10 computers instead of 10 typewriters. Normally, they have periodically replaced typewriters and updated their equipment. What is proposed here is purchasing 10 new computers. The math department is also requesting 10 computers, and between the two requests, you would end up with a computer facility that would have computers that will run updated software. It would be sufficient for business class instruction, but also used for math, science, for that matter, social studies, and English. The whole school is really beginning to use the computer lab very substantially. Our current computers, I think I'll discuss in more detail when I get to math, but suffice it to say, for the purposes of the business department, the Apple IIe's that are there are wearing out. The software is not useful in terms of teaching students how to type in any sense that's similar to current office practices or really personal typing. The software seems to have frustrated the teachers in the last 2 years, and in fact this fall, after trying it for 3 weeks, they simply gave up, and all the students and teachers agreed they were better off going back to electric typewriters. Very few offices use typewriters in the same way that they used to. People word process. We simply need some word processors that work well. Also, the accounting classes need spreadsheets, programs that work well. And IBM or Macintosh computers both run excellent spreadsheets as well as have very fine word processors. So that is the basis of that request. Coming back to computers later on, so we have plenty of time to... English department, the text line is down. It's lower than usual, but the department feels that the request that they have made will be sufficient for their needs. In fine arts, there's very little change. We are moving the current visual arts program second floor of the school down to the industrial technology wing. We're also moving the dark room out of a science classroom and down to the industrial technology wing. Art, graphic arts, drafting will all sort of share one common facility. The faculty of both the art and technology departments are very excited about that possibility. They will be able to share equipment and share facilities in a way that I think will enhance both their instruction. Their classes really need the equipment that the other department now has. In so doing, we will free up really three classrooms. Part of the science room has been used to teach photography for the last 4 or 5 years. That will become entirely a physics classroom. We will then be able to move a biology lab into what is now another science classroom, creating space for the math department, which is being displaced by the kindergarten. Likewise, the social studies department will be moving to the second floor and moving into the two classrooms that are now one large art room. So by moving art down to industrial technology, we really gained three classrooms, which help offset kindergarten move into the high school. We really need that space. Foreign language, the budget is down a little bit. They are continuing to replace texts, and they're very much looking forward to the first class of students from the FLES program in middle school, and have done a lot of placement work in the middle school in the last couple of weeks. David Perry and Judy Liberty have worked with middle school and elementary school French teachers to assess students' proficiency and make some recommendations for placement next year. And they're just continuing to replace some of their texts. No significant change, I think, in the health or PE budget. Technology has trimmed its budget a little bit in a few places where it can. Other than that, there's no substantive change there. Mathematics, however, is up by a sizable amount of money, most of which is computers. There really is also an increase in the texts. This year, they're going to finish buying University of Chicago texts. They'll buy, I think, 100 Algebra 2 texts or advanced Algebra texts. They will buy 25 calculus texts and buy 25 calculus texts. That should pretty much complete the replacement of mathematics textbooks. There is also a substantial request for 10 computers. A very important part of the math program now is using computers and software provided by the University of Chicago, as well as some third-party software in mathematics. The current Apple IIe's simply are not functioning well. They're literally breaking down. They are wearing out. The software for the upper-level math programs is not being written for the Apple IIe. Algebra 1 and geometry software is available from the University of Chicago on the Apple IIe, but their better software is available on the Macintosh and the IBM, and they're the only software that they write for the upper-level math courses is on the IBM or Macintosh. This year, we are really using the computer lab. It's hard to give a multiple to it, but we're using it, I think, on average. Talking to the math teachers last week, we're using it probably 6 out of 8 periods on average during the day, which is a big change from the past. Math classes are in there, groups of students are in there. The math department has changed the way it's teaching. It is asking students to do research projects and to do demonstrations and exhibitions involving the computer, so that students are required to go into the lab, use the machines, print out materials, and hand in, if you will, their research projects, having used the computer. All of that is significantly changing the way the computers are being used. I think it's an important difference. What we're trying to do is get machines that ultimately will become, I think, transparent. That is to say, students will not think a lot about using the computer as a tool. They will think about mathematics, and the computer will fade into the background very much the way most of us use calculators or pencils. We don't think much about the hardware. We think about the ideas, and that's what we would like students to do. It's very difficult for them to do it if the machinery they have doesn't permit them to do the thinking. It's also difficult and frustrating if it breaks down. So that we are requesting really an updating of the high school computer facilities. Now, I have not done that for the last 2 years in any significant way because the instructional program was not driving such a request. This year, it is very significantly driving that request. That is, I think several years ago, we made a decision, I think 3 years ago, to cut most of the computers out of the budget. I think that would be a really serious mistake, even though this is a significant outlay of money. It's sort of a chicken and the egg syndrome. It's difficult for students and faculty to learn to use computers well if they don't have good computers to use. And you can sort of argue that, well, we won't buy them computers until they know how to use them well, but they really need, I think, the technology to begin to use it and learn what it can do. I think this is true particularly in science as well. The science department is now exploring software that's available in physics, chemistry, earth science, and biology. What we would like to do is have machines that students could do sophisticated problems on, and for example, graph the solution to a physics experiment, and then be able to see graphically what will happen as they change variables to, in a sense, run what-if questions on a computer and use it to think. It simply requires better computing facilities. So that's the basis of our request. Pause and see what questions people may have, or do you want me to just keep going and come back to it?
Mr. Miles?
Sir.
So the request for both business and math is a total of 10 computers?
It's a total of 20 computers. 20 computers. And we've listed both IBM and Macintosh. I think we are going to look carefully at, if we are able to do this, we are going to investigate very carefully which kind of computers we want. We may want to mix, we may want all of one or the other, because one of the powers of computers is networking the computers. You can share printers, you can also communicate between the computers, and there are some important advantages in that. Several of us yesterday went to Gorham to talk with Wally Zyko at Gorham. Tony recommended that we go talk to him. Gorham has done some very interesting piloting of how to use computer technology. And we have actually got some of the pieces in place that in terms of our thinking, that they have experimented with, but they are much further along than we are. They are using computers in the lower grades, I think, in a way that I know we would like to do here, ultimately. But one of the important things is to begin to have students use computers as part of the assessment for the work they do in many different courses, so that the computers and the technology are an important piece of asking students to provide, if you will, papers, experiments, models in mathematics, which can illustrate the kind of thinking the students have done. And that's what we really need to move towards.
I have one other question.
Sure.
It's concerning your statement about the current eighth grade class in the high school assuming part of the computer literacy requirement. I guess what I need to know is what ramifications it's going to have on you and staffing, and what ramifications it's going to have on the middle school. Is there going to be a decrease in middle school and an increase in the high school?
I don't think so. We are considering a different kind of defining our computer literacy requirement differently. When schools first began to deal with computers, I think the focus was on the machine and the software, how to run the machine, how to turn it on, how to use a word processor. There is a need for some instruction in that, and the students in the district get that kind of instruction in, currently in fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and somewhat eighth grade. And I think the proposal is that they will continue to get some of that. But more and more, I think students very quickly move beyond the stage of having a need to know how to use the computer rudimentary level. And I think what's more important is to, instead of having computer literacy classes, let them learn by using in math classes, in science classes, also in social studies classes, as their teachers integrate use of the computer into instruction. They simply learn as they need to, if you will, about the machine, and the focus becomes really the thinking they can do with it rather than the machine or the software itself. Most of us who use computers have spent time figuring out how to use it by reading software manuals. Students do that very well. They do it as well, if not better, than we do, and they teach each other very quickly. Here's how you do it. So I don't think the school needs to spend as much time on, if you will, on a how-to basis in terms of using the machine. What we need to do is help them do more sophisticated thinking. They'll use the machine just fine. They are very quick to help each other, and I think in conjunction with the math classes in the high school, and also I think the classes that they have in the middle school, both in math and in other areas, they will be, if you will, computer literate in the old sense of the word. I think a different sense of the word is emerging, where where computer literacy means, are you able to use it for some sophisticated thinking? That's what we want to focus on. I don't see us requesting another teacher necessarily for that. But I think there are courses in the high school where we're integrating the instruction in both business, technology, exploring next year a science and technology course that's team taught with, where students will get some computer literacy in use, but they won't necessarily have a class. That makes sense?
I have one other question, but I will reserve that when the middle school gives their presentation about the computer.
I move on to the science department budget. There is a substantial increase here as well. And that's reflected really in some serious requests for textbooks in a number of areas, particularly in biology. One of the ways of teaching biology that some previous instructors in the school used most was lecture and or, it's hard to describe how Gene Tebow used text, because he basically had written some of the texts and had them in his head and had all the manipulatives, but really didn't hand out text to students, nor did Hal Hackett. Our current teachers, however, are using texts in a little different way, and I think need some textbooks that are updated from the biology texts that we currently have. Most of the biology texts were sparsely used in the past. I think we have about, we have enough texts for students, but many of them are out of date somewhat. So there's a proposal to buy a number of biology texts, 70 biology texts, some marine biology texts, some advanced biology textbooks. There's a request for some texts in earth science, a set of physics books, and some chemistry lab manuals. So there's a substantial amount of text requested in science. There's also some additional equipment requested. In biology, a take-apart human torso, some microscopes, and then there's a set of classroom furniture for the chemistry lab, the equipment additional. So that should explain what those lines are. In social studies, I think the only significant change is the amount of summer work. They are making, I think, a lot of changes in their curriculum, using the library as a resource center, doing a lot of research work, and they would like to spend some time getting that organized and developing that material.
Frank, may I just ask a question regarding textbooks and software under social studies?
Sure.
And is that more software than textbooks? Do you use periodicals more than?
No, I think that's, let me give you a more accurate answer here, because I can tell you exactly what it
is. The world's changing so quickly, and I think you have an outdated textbook.
No, it's here. I just need to get the right page. It's just not in the order that I anticipated it would be. But, here we go. It's really a variety of text. And I think there's really no significant replacement of one course text. It's 30 books here, 10 books there, 10 books here and there. All of which, because given the price of books, and actually these are not necessarily some of the expensive books. I mean, it's just a smattering of different books. I'd be glad to give you the list if you like it.
Well,
No, it's not US history of replacing, that's why I have not flagged it in my own notes and in another worksheet. It's just a series of replacements in my textbooks.
Thank you.
The total you see for instructional accounts really is, if you subtract salaries out of the instruction amount, what you see there for $133,000 is what it costs. That's what the instructional program, in some sense, costs, the stuff of it. I would say more substantially the stuff of it's in the teachers, but it's improvements as well, I would say. I think the next part of the budget where there's a series of increases is in the library. This is the second year that we have going to work on improving the library program. If you have questions, we happen to have an expert sitting with us in the form of Joyce Bell, who's our librarian. I have given you a copy of the three-year plan. Last year was a four-year plan. We're now down to a three-year plan, and each year it'll get slightly shorter as Joyce tries to get us, if you will, online and have a really useful resource and research center in the school. I must say that the equipment that she purchased this past year has made a profound impact on the way students use the library. The library is really a busy research center in the school now, and students continually comment on how much more useful it is, how much more accessible the information is. It's not just the machines that are there. The collection is being updated. Faculty and students are responding very positively to the use of the library. So although there is some significant investment here, I think it's an investment that's going to make the library the heart of the school and allow us to really run a school where the library is the research and resource center for the whole school. And as we try to get students to become inquirers, they need a well-equipped resource center as a sort of a hub for their investigative activities.
Mr. Miles?
Sir.
Is there any way that, because I've heard from students also that they're very impressed with what's happening in the library, is there any way that we can measure usage in numbers? Does the librarian keep track of the number of requests or that kind of thing?
What I'm keeping close track of is how often libraries are used by teachers for whatever purpose, whether it's a research paper or a chemistry project where a student has to come in and use real detailed specific sources. We have been keeping circulation records, but they are less accurate or less representative of the true use of the library, in that lots of sources are used but not checked out. So it gives us an idea of how many books are unchecked out, but for me the most important thing is what departments are involved in integrating the library with their curricular areas. And that I'm keeping close track of, and I use that in monitoring where I need to increase my collection. In addition to, of course, talking with the teachers and departments.
Is the middle school media center aware of what you, I'm sure they're aware of what you have. Do they send students or teachers to you or?
They don't necessarily send students to us. They send requests to me, and I'm happy always to photocopy or send information to them as needed. But the teachers have occasionally come up to me. Is open to anybody
K-12. I'm just wondering how much it was utilized. You know, I want to prevent duplication in an age of telecommunications, et cetera, and you're using a lot of microfilm and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm.
Shari Hagen and I meet monthly to talk about what is happening in our libraries. And one of the things we've done is we've included in our plan at the request of Connie, a separate technology plan so that we avoid all of that duplication. And we've also included Thomas Memorial in that plan as well, so that eventually we'll have all three libraries on one computer network. This is down the road, of course, but it will also help us avoid duplication.
I just wonder how much encouragement is generated in the middle school to utilize that facility, because when my children have come home that to do research that they can't find in their own library, the high school library's not even considered. So I wonder if that's even educated to the middle school students, that they have an excellent resource right in this community.
I think we could work on that more. This is really our first year of trying to get together the three of us, and we were focusing primarily on technology and duplication in that area. But I think we could do that, certainly. Getting the word out to the middle school teachers.
Thank you.
Through the office of the principal, I think the major change in that budget is we are consolidating the office of the principal and the main office into one office, and the principal's office will move upstairs. That will allow us to reduce by one staff position. We'll have two secretaries in the main office and two secretaries in the guidance office. At the same time that we're reorganizing the main office, we're reorganizing the guidance office, support staff a little bit. We actually collaborate closely in a lot of administrative parts of the school program, and we will be distributing the workload of those two offices amongst the various people in each office. We feel we can do this and not reduce the effectiveness of services to the school or the community. What we're trying to do at the same time is, in order to do that, improve our computer facilities there this year by having a network that allows us to use our student database by more than one person at a time, and also to get cut down on duplication of different kind of computer systems we use, so that we can in fact exchange information from one computer to the other, which is now not so easily done, since we have a mix of Apple IIe's, two IBM's, and two different Macintoshes. And so we're trying to, the Macintoshes and IBM's can exchange information, but the Apples that are used cannot. So we're proposing that we replace those Apple IIe's with the inexpensive Macintoshes, and make that switch at the same time that we cut down and consolidate our support staff. This year that results in a saving of about $8,000. Since I would not anticipate that in the future year we would have the same amount of need for computer equipment, in the long run that's going to result in savings, I think, on an annual basis of about $12,000. When I say savings, I'm not sure we're saving any, but we've used that to some, in one sense you could say we're using that to update other parts of our program without adding to the budget more. That's the way we'd like to look at it. I think that in the long run we will be able to run the school very effectively with the support staff that we'll have next year. And I think that by having the principal and the assistant principal in the same place, we'll enhance our own collaboration too. We look forward to it. We spent a lot of time working with guidance counselors and with our secretarial staff to try and figure out how this might happen, to make sure that people, we've thought through the different tasks and functions, and I think we would be able to pull it off very nicely. Special education, I think, is probably the next area where there's a significant change, and that's simply because we're taking on the tuition from the middle school of a severely handicapped student. So that accounts for a substantial change in the budget, in the tuition and other, if you will, line on the special education budget, which went from zero to 61,800. Sure.
Frank, I have to include Park Hope and Middle School in this question, if you don't mind.
I don't mind.
The 61,800 that's in that line, I was looking for a corresponding decrease in the middle school, but there's only a $29,000 decrease in the middle school, although there's also a $29,500 decrease in Park Hope, which is very close to $61,000. But since it's only one student, I was just wondering why.
In general, what that, as far as the middle school situation, we have more students, a variety, moving into the special services, into that grade level. So what you're getting there is a net effect. It's not simply track. In some cases, it's tracking one person.
It does, but in the narrative it said that there was one middle school student.
There's one middle school student who moves up next year from the middle school. Okay. That one middle school student was very expensive and was moved into the middle school budget for last year. But there are also two elementary students who are moving into middle school. So that
also,
I just got it. I just wanted to be black and white, you know.
Yeah, it's not. Well, there are a lot of takes where it has to do. Five or six students that
I just think
it's going to have a significant impact. I think probably in the next, unless there are questions about co-curricular athletics, I've also included in the budget, the back two pages of your budget, I've included a breakdown of all the athletic costs by sport. Either the last page or the third from the last page. I also have a breakdown of the teaching sections in the high school back there for you. But you can see exactly what each sport costs. Keith and I have worked this out over the last 2 years, and we find it very useful for our own purposes in terms of looking at how our sports program operates. So the total cost for really, again, 610 students in sports, sort of an average of roughly $260 per sport. And it's a simple figure, but per student. Now that's per student athlete in a given sport. Yeah, there's a duplication. Some students are three sports.
Per student. Or three students, one student in three sports, $3,600.
Exactly. One student in three sports would be $780, roughly. But each participant in the team. And, you know, I think that there's no great surprise in terms of which sports cost money in a significant. When you own your own swimming pool, you don't necessarily always get a picture of what it costs to swim. But you own your gymnasium, how much it costs to play basketball. When we have to put a new roof on the gym, I'm not sure we charge that out to basketball or any device that we're lucky. But there's a spreadsheet there that breaks that down for you. Cook? Yes?
Frank, I have a couple of questions about the sports. One is that, is it safe to say that if it were not for very active fundraising efforts by the Boosters, these figures would be much higher?
Figures for hockey?
No, for all sports.
I think we have very active Boosters organizations in all sports, but in hockey in particular, Boosters provide a lot of money for the support of the hockey team. They provide, they provide uniforms, they provide salary for the JV coach. They really substantially support that program. I think in the other programs, what the Boosters do is provide auxiliary support for the programs. I think in most of the other sports, the school is actually paying for the basic costs of each sport. Only in hockey are the Boosters really providing for support for half that program. Well, lacrosse maybe, I'm not sure of that. I can check for you.
No, I just thought...
I'll get Pete to give you a ring, because he really knows the funding inside and out on that. My understanding was that hockey was provided a lot of the expenses, very expensive to support a hockey program.
And the parents got that.
The parents worked very hard to do that.
But the
Boosters in all the sports are very active, but I think in hockey, they just provide an amazing amount of, it's just expensive sport.
Then my second question, I believe this is an appropriate time to bring it up. I have asked a couple of the board members as the finance committee and also had the opportunity to talk with the AD and the assistant AD separately about the idea of an equipment fee per student for purposes of replacing consumables. And my big concern is a year from now we'll have 50 additional students in the high school. And we have equipment and uniforms that are not being replaced right now at the rate they're being used up. And I was wondering if at some point we can have some discussion on that concept and make a policy decision if that's the appropriate way to go, about whether or not that is acceptable.
If you're asking me, problem with the discussion. I have no particular recommendation for whether or not the board wants to have an activity fee for participation in the sport. My understanding is that would be a fee paid once during the school year.
And
is
I'm
that correct?
7-12, not just 9-12. And it would be something that parents would probably pay quite willingly based on the fact that beginning in the seventh grade, fees that they used to pay to community services are no longer there because their kids are participating in the school sports program. And I have talked with many, many parents about this idea with no objection. Well, two.
I wasn't, Peter.
I thought you could speak for yourself. So I call that little resistance.
I'm not quite sure whether this is a budget item or a policy item, because it opens the door to users' fees of all types, athletics, extracurricular activities. And I really don't have a view as to how we should handle it, perhaps something else to.
I would agree. I don't think that it needs to be settled at this budget workshop. I think it is a very interesting and timely thought. I would be inclined to address it in a regular school board meeting and not have it affect this coming budget. Probably look at it for the coming year after this budget cycle.
I think we might have to address it at some time. If for some reason that we put forth a budget and we're told by town council that this is what we're saying tax rate, and we have to go back and look at some cuts. We may have to look at some of these co-curricular and athletic programs, and one of the ways might be to offset the cuts that we make would be some kind of an activities or a equipment fee. So I think we may revisit this before the end of this budget session.
Any other comments?
About the budget in general? I
know about this subject?
No.
No, I'm not quite. I'm sure you'll have comments about the budget in general. I think beyond athletics, just looking at the operations and maintenance part of our budget, change that is substantial in the contract repairs of the building is the need in the high school for a new public address system, an intercom system. We currently have a system that for a number of years has not worked as an intercom system. That is, you cannot call from a classroom to the main office, period. There is a PA system, and what we have been using is a console that was put into the building in 1971 when the building was built. It is fairly typical in many high schools. And hardwired into the wall was a phone system. Over the years, the phones have disappeared from the classrooms. Many schools now do not use phones, they simply use two-way speaker systems that speak right into the speaker and mind operates just the way a speakerphone does. But in any case, the heart of that system, the console in the main office, is, I think, can charitably be described as limping along. There have been several breakdowns during the year. The audibility of the system is questionable every time we turn it on. In fact, we cannot move some of the switches out of the positions in which they're taped. They're taped that way so that nobody would move them, because if they do move them, it simply ruins the system and we can't repair it. We can't get parts for it. It's worn out. This is the simple way to put it. And we are proposing that we contract with the firm to replace and upgrade that system. I think replace is more like it. We're not going to have anything very elaborate. We'll have a communication system that will allow us to have clearly audible announcements in the building, which we don't have now. We will have a system that will allow us to shut off the speakers in some rooms, for example, the kindergarten rooms, if we are making announcements to the high school and not interfere with the kindergarten program. That capacity was built into our current system, but as they say, the console doesn't work anymore, so we can't even do that. So we feel that it's time to replace that. So that is the reason for almost a $10,000 increase in that particular account. The other expenditures in that account are fairly consistent from year to year. They involve paying contracts, different kinds of contract repairs to the buildings that Gary puts in the budget on an annual basis as part of the maintenance program. There are some decreases in the operations and maintenance budget. There's a significant decrease in energy conservation expense because of the work that has been done over the past several years. Other than that, I don't think any great variation. That, I think, pretty much goes over the significant variances from one year to the other in the high school budget. If you have any questions.
The PA system is $9,460.
No, the PA system is, I think, Gary estimates it roughly $10,000. It's just, there's another little, there are a few other puts and takes in that account, but it's roughly $10,000.
Are you going to give any consideration to hardwiring that possible use of computers and your file servers that you want to have workstations in classrooms?
I think what we will do if we are able to go ahead on this is perhaps try to get some more free advice from the person who helped us buy a telephone system a few years ago, works at UNM, because we were able to, I think, get a very good phone system that we would not have been able to buy ourselves. We would have asked the right questions. She does this for a living. She is very good. And it may be that putting telephones, I mean, it sounds crazy, but the technology is that we don't want telephones in the classrooms for a lot of reasons that come quickly to mind in terms of what students, the problem of security of, but the technology of communications and telephones is such that you could basically do that and have a PA system that would do all of what you're saying. It would be hardwired, would allow modems, would allow anything you wanted to do.
So you're going to look into that?
So we're going to look into that. But we have basically looked at what would it cost us to replace what we have now using exists. There is wire, you can run to every classroom. And we are told by the people that we've done some exploration with, that that's, the wiring is good, could be used by a variety of different technologies or different systems. So we are looking at that. But we will explore that, because it does become clear that in all spaces, that communications technology changes so rapidly that you can really do things you just wouldn't have thought of.
Any other questions from the board?
What is the environment? I assume that's ENV, is environmental consultation under operations and maintenance. I know it shows up for every school.
That's the asbestos training and HIP hazard training. There are a variety of things we're now required to do. In some cases, train new employees, upgrade understanding of those issues. In some cases, that's also an allowance for an emergency response to any of those hazardous substance areas. And most of that is a requirement.
I asked that question. I think there's $600, which is for a course for Gary to go to. He is really a designated school employee, not just in the high school, but he serves for the whole system.
Well, that's what I was kind of wondering then. Do we have to, does someone from every single school building have to do that? I mean, or is there one person from the system who can become the big expert on that? Or?
Well, Gary is our expert. He's really the point person. That's part of his duties under the piece of the reorganization we already accomplished in asking him to be maintenance person for the district. There are some aspects of this that we frankly are still pinning them. There were some laws passed that had some requirements for a designated person. You have to have certain amounts of training and so on and so forth. There were some issues early on about insurance coverage, how to frame it. There have been some unanswered issues over a period of years from federal legislation as well as state legislation. But frankly, from a practical point of view, what we have to do is make sure that we have somebody available who is trained to deal with, supposing we had, and as what's known as an asbestos emergency, which might be something as simple as a leak coming down through ceiling tiles that have been identified as ACBMs, asbestos-carrying materials. We've already, by law, gone through a variety of identification procedures. We have those pieces of information on file. Gary is one who's most familiar with them, but other people on staff hasn't have some familiarity. And we're getting better at understanding what that law now requires. But that's intended to be yearly training or spot response or sending our people to necessary training, that kind of thing.
Sorry, keep going.
On the co-curricular,
sure.
At a board meeting a couple months back, I think we had asked if you, you could to do job descriptions,
right,
and get a handle on the hours.
I am in the process of doing that. I have put out in the last month a memo to faculty members. They are trickling in, and I will try to encourage them to speed that up. We have a number of those coming in. Type that up and give you a breakdown. And the hours, in fact, that you did for the some of the negotiations in terms of co-curricular hours. So we need to get that data. So some of these job descriptions really don't exist, and they are writing, which is something we need to do, because it will be informative for everybody. It's the bottom line to start with. So that is in process.
And on the move of the visual arts program,
yep.
Where is that in the scale of priorities? Is that something that would just be really nice to do, or something?
We don't move the visual arts
critical?
Program. We don't have three classrooms to use for social studies, math.
So it has to move.
We have to move the art room. The art room in the high school is a divided divider's actually been removed, but it's simply in storage. We'll put it back up, create two classrooms. What we are planning to do is, math is going to share some rooms with current business classrooms and three rooms on the third floor, in amongst the science rooms, and social studies is going to be downstairs with English. And we need that space. We are counting on that space.
What about the dark room then?
The dark room, I think is an important facility in the school. What we're doing is adapting a home economics room, which currently has a room divider between that and a drafting room, but we're putting a wall down the middle. There's an island, I don't know whether you know the room, but there's an island in it down here.
The room where community services is at, cooking classes and so on.
And creating a dark room there, and simply making, it's really not a lot of construction, but in order to make all of that comply with code, turns out that it's not inexpensive to do. But once that's done, that will be a facility that will serve both the graphics classes and the photography classes. We have, I think, a very active photography program at the moment, and students use it, like it. I think it's a wonderfully taught class. Gary Lunoy has wanted to have access to a dark room for each of the last 2 years. This takes place, it will happen. Current dark room is located in a prep room adjacent to a physics room. But that prep room is because the kindergarten is, because the nurse's office is being moved out of the kindergarten wing, the nurse's office is moving into the current dark room. Now, if we don't move the nurse's office, we still need to move the dark room if we want to consolidate the classrooms the way we are. But in fact, that space will be there. But it's a question of then where do you teach what courses. What we're trying to do is, I think we will just, if you will just fit, and it's not just we'll fit fine next year, but I'm talking about 4 years from now when we have 160 students, we will be sharing all the rooms in the school. For one more year, we will not have quite that kind of problem, but we will have no extra rooms. Here we have extra rooms. We are really reconfiguring the space and I think using it better by both having the kindergarten here as well as having the high school space that has used this intensively in the past. That expense is part of the $22,000 that was on the overhead that Tom showed earlier.
Charlie?
Yes, sir. Mr. Miles, looking at some of your teacher section size and course loads.
Sure.
Maybe you could I know it has a lot to do with scheduling, but looking at health in particular, and looking at this end, there seems to be quite a disparity in class size. I think the one that bothers me the most is a ninth grade class of 7 students, and you have classes as large as 23. I just wonder how effective.
I think the classes are effective. I'm not going to defend the variation between 23 and 7, or in some cases 26 and small numbers. It really is a function of what classes meet at what time and what students are free for different courses. So that in a number of cases, even though when we build a master schedule, we try to even out the classes that we simply can't in some situations, and we're stuck with it. I don't know whether that answers your question. I know you're not any happier with it. But we do the best we can with that. It happens in areas other than health as well. There's some math classes that are, some of that are small and some that are large. And again, that's a variation of the scheduling as well.
Also under industrial technology, there are a couple of courses that only had like 3 students in them.
Right. What industrial tech department has done is to have several classes sometimes that are small, medium, they can share both, they can share lab space and they can share teachers.
So they're actually meeting at the same time?
In some cases they are, this is the architectural drafting classes that are small.
Under business education, you have currently 8 students doing keyboarding. Are these students who did not meet their proficiency in eighth grade?
The keyboarding is typing, it's essentially, it's a typing class. It's called, the new term is keyboarding.
Changing the terms so that you continue to confuse.
I would hope that they had learned some typing or keyboarding skills in their, elementary computer courses.
Must have been caught my eye too.
I think they have learned some, but I think it's not the same kind of, I'm not certain what kind of instruction they're going to, they're getting in fourth or fifth grade in terms of keyboarding. But what is offered in the high school is a typing course that is, I would say a more contemporary version of probably the typing course you might have taken.
I guess I can warn the middle school principal that I'm going to, revisit this computer keyboarding.
I think this is still a little red.
What is the plans for the lecture hall?
I think you may want to answer that.
Yes, we definitely have our eye set on redoing that. However, as I look at the figures that are coming in on the things that we have to do, you will recall, I'm sure, that I have said that I can see for sure how we were going to be able to do it in this year's budget. Obviously, it's not in there, and that when you look at the numbers as they are, we stretch them about as far as we can. We will be continuing to plan for that and have figures, because I do think that not only from the standpoint of either the kindergarten and community services use of that room, we saw other uses really that would expand the use of it as it's currently used. But we don't have firm figures on that, but we've been using a kind of a 70,000 figure, which I don't see. I didn't put it in because I didn't see how we could.
Okay, is there no further, John?
Under employee development, it's kind of hard to, I guess this is broken down by department.
Yeah, that is.
I guess you.
In general, there's.
Could you just explain the departments that seem to have the biggest decreases?
Well, there's not.
Well, number two has a decrease from 1,000 to essentially 400, so there's a 680.
That's a tuition reimbursement.
Is this a reimbursable, a state reimbursable?
No, this is a contract issue that according to the contract that the teachers have, if they take a course, they get credit for it, the district reimburses them at a certain rate as stipulated in the employee's contract.
A certain number of credit hours.
I understand that part.
And they are asked to warn us in advance of those possible expenditures if we make an allocation in the budget.
It's just that your cover letter said because the state budget format includes a reimbursable category that.
No, that's for employee development in general, and D, you'll have to answer that because I'm parroting what you do. I asked the question, why do we have it separated too, Charles?
Just in the past 3 or 4 years, we've separated this because the state at times comes out with a survey as to how much we spend for employee development district-wide, so it's an easy way to identify and not have to go through a lot of these accounts.
Okay, our PRDTC assessment, that's what we have to pay as a
tuition for the vocational.
More particularly, that's upfront costs that we are assessed on a per pupil status, depending on how many youngsters we have the year before in various programs. It's not, we don't tuition kids to the vocational regional school. That is their basic attendance there as part of the general agreement that sets that school up and makes it available to the city schools. A few years ago, Portland petitioned and was granted by the board that governs it the right to assess us what are known as upfront costs for replacement of equipment or for funding new programs. So that is a portion assessed at a different rate every year, depending on the number of students you have, to help Portland cope with those unusual expenses.
So how many students utilize?
We have about 7 students.
And you don't expect that to change, like, you just say the assessment?
The number may go up or down, student or two, but roughly, we expect somewhere between 7 and 10 students.
We would be assessed on the number we have this year.
There's a change in the last several years, this vocational training center has now permitted 10th graders to attend instead of just 11th and 12th graders. And we are trying to advise some of our students who may be interested in that program to take advantage of that opportunity. So that's why there may be some variation. We'll know more about that in the next month because we are just handing out course registration materials, student course guides. In fact, we're going to do that tomorrow afternoon. So the next week or so, high school students will be making their initial course selections, and middle school students will also get those materials. We have an 8th grade parents night next Monday night. So we're in that process. So we'll have some enrollment figures for next year in terms of initial course selection. Please call me if you've got some questions. You get a chance to look it over because I really would like you to understand it. It's not just simple.
Well, I was just wondering, is there a base number of students you have to have in a class to consider it reasonable to carry that class?
In general, yes. And the number is about 10. On the other hand, there are certain classes that we carry with a smaller number. Industrial technology has tried to keep as many different options open for students as possible. They usually teach about 6 courses and they combine some of the small numbers there. So that, in a Woods class, you also have some of the kids who are doing boat building. I think there are more, I noticed the 3 there. There are more than 3 boats going up in that shop. So I think there are more kids in boat building than 3 at the moment. But they're very good about that. But in other programs, advanced physics or fifth year of languages, we want to keep that option there. And those classes, I think 3 or 4 years ago, were all above 10, 12, something like that. It's just as the high school in the last 2 years sort of hit this bottom of the curve. They should rise again shortly too. But in general, if we don't get students, we ask some very hard questions. And in some cases, it's a serious question not to ask. Is this course or is this program viable?
Well, it seems to me that there are probably some areas that if you get to a low count, but it's still a valuable class in some way, we should probably be looking at other communities to pool some of our resources so that kids are still offered those opportunities that may not always be at the school. Or
That's a good point. We are looking, we're interested in that in a number of areas. We do that with some language courses with Portland. For example, that's how students take Chinese and Russian. And we're also looking at it, we're talking with South Portland about alternative educational programs that maybe that South Portland and Kate Elizabeth could consider sharing how, when, where, and what expense. We have not even got a clue at this point. We have some ideas. And maybe that Scarborough, which is also contiguous with really both towns, could share some of that.
Let us know how you do with that.
It is. It's interesting to all of the schools because we're all facing the same cost crunch.
Rosemary.
Just a comment. I had an opportunity while I was making use of the Graphics Communications Lab 2 weeks ago to observe architectural drafting and design 1, 2, and 3 with freshmen, juniors, seniors. All in one classroom and one instructor handling it very, very ably. So I just wanted to point that out because I was quite impressed that we had such a large age range, and then to find out that they were all doing 3 different courses. more pressing to me.
Shows you the Little Red Schoolhouse is not dead.
Actually,
it's a good concept.
Yeah, I think many high school classes in really in all subjects, but particularly in fine arts and in technology, but really in a number of departments where they're cross-graded and students think very little about it.
I thought that was important, but then when I found out he was teaching three different courses at the same time, I thought I'd mention.
It's heterogeneous grouping in its most extreme.
Modern school. Before we move on, if we're finished with board questions, begin to make some comments from the public, if there are any. I'd just like to reiterate what Connie said earlier. We still don't have a state printout. And that makes it very hard for us to really get down the brass tacks. Another thing that we do not have, which we had this time last year, was a very strong indication from the, very specific indication from the town council as to what we should be shooting for. That introduces two variables, and it makes it quite hard for us to really tear into this budget and either add or delete more than we have. But so to those who are observing this, I just want to point that out, and I'd also like to point out how much work has gone into this already. Look at Principal Miles, the three-ring notebook, and the number of sheets in it. It looks like about 400, in which every single department and every single expense has been looked at in great detail. So having said that, I would invite comments from members of the public. Come forward where the television camera can see you, or how are you doing this evening? And identify yourself.
Okay, Martha Clark. I don't have a high school student yet, but I'm interested in the computers. I like the idea of using the computer as a tool. I want to know how well trained are your faculty to do this? Are they going to need further education themselves, or are they prepared for that?
I think they're reasonably well prepared, but they do need training as well. And we have a number of faculty members who are teaching each other, because a number of them are really quite proficient. I think all of us are learning constantly about how to better use the computer. And for most of us, it's a self-teaching process. A number of staff members have taken courses at Harper Computer. Some are taking summer workshops involving the use of computer software. Mr. Weatherby was in a program last year with Bowdoin where they loaned him a computer. We got a phone line in, connected him with a modem to other physics teachers in the state. And it's that kind of in-service educational program that I think is helping the staff. There's also a lot of new software being written for sophisticated math and science at all levels, middle schools, all high schools. And I think we're just making a big steps, if you will, each year in terms of what's available. It's an important question because contemporary in our science faculty, for example, two of our younger faculty members have gone to college and been used to using computers. In a sense, they've grown up with it in the last 10 years. Some of our older faculty members who are interested in use computers have had to learn it themselves because, being roughly my age, we didn't go to school with computers in quite the same way we expect our students to. So it is a retraining problem for all of us.
I think it's an excellent question. I think that when we look at this subject of the 10 or so computers, we ought to look at it in the context not only of the lady's question, but also what is our long-range plan? How are we going to tie in this with the library, with CD-ROM? And people that are much more expert than I am look into the future and try to look at least 5 years down the road I'm somewhat appalled here that we have Macs, Apple IIIs, and IBM. I'd sort of like to know how that happened. I hope I wasn't one of the people who approved it. But the concept of freestanding computers that aren't linked together and that aren't part of a long-range capital investment program. It's a difficult one for me.
Well, it's an important question, and one of the questions we explored yesterday with Wally Zyko, because in fact, that's where Gorham has made done some real pioneering work, and Connie can tell you a little bit more about Zyko. We found him fascinating. Gorham has, in fact, begun to develop, the word media center is a little bit of a cliche, but basically that's what it involves, including networked computers with CD-ROM, with laser printers, with copy machines all available, and students do some really interesting things, including they have some interesting projects that they've funded through some foundations and private money involving their elementary school, which are exploring that. And I think Mrs. Bell and Ross and our computer coordinator and I were, I think, all struck by the need for long-range planning, not just in the high school, but really in the school district. I think the librarians have begun to ask those questions about library facilities. And I think as we renovate the middle school, we need to integrate technology. And I know that Nancy Hutton has that on her mind, as do her teachers. And we are looking at ways to network computers. And one of the things that occurred to us yesterday, we have requests here for both IBMs and Macintoshes. We need to rethink that, because the networking possibilities are not so simple with two different machines. So we may be much better off, say, if we buy 20 computers, buying them all of one kind, because they're much more easily networked.
Well, I just want to...
And that's, I think, very, very important, and that's exactly our problem in the main office. We are upgrading a network so that people can use the material that we have, the hardware that we have at the same time.
Well, it may be that the comment about IBM and Apple company is no longer valid, because, as a matter of fact, this Apple breeds MS DOS.
Sure.
And so Apple and IBM have recently made some sort of an agreement, which again, technically, is beyond me. I love their software, but I don't understand the hardware, where basically their computers are going to speak to each other much more easily than they have in the past, as this one does. But I certainly am in favor of moving ahead on the computers, and I recognize from any number of angles, but the one that surprised me the most recently was the trip to Thornton Academy. I think you were on that trip. Who else was? Anyway, Thornton Academy is just light years ahead of us in the use of computers in their library, and we are way, way behind in this, and it's surprising for a community like this to be as far behind as it appeared to me. What was your trip to Gorham like? Are we, again, way behind in terms of...
I'm not sure we're way behind. I think we're behind Gorham a little bit in hardware, but we're well behind them conceptually. They're out in front. They've done some really interesting thinking. You're correct. We need to sit down, and we intend to do that. We're, in a sense, in the process of doing that, which is why we've made these different trips to see what's happening. We're well aware where we are. Our students have better computing facilities at home than they do in school, and that's a real liability. So there are machines in school that they can do their work on, because they have IBMs or Macs, and we have relatively few of those.
Well, I heard Gorham had a pretty good superintendent a couple of years ago.
Technologically,
anyway. Any other comments from the public?
Mine would be following up on your comment, Peter, on computers. Even though your computer might read MS-DOS, it may not network with an IBM computer.
Well, yes, you're quite right.
So, but I'm concerned about this issue, because you're coming at it from the standpoint of the math department would like 10, and the science department would like 10, and the central office needs 4 or 5 for their networking purposes, and there's no real long-range vision as to what it is that you want to eventually end up with when you have this hodgepodge put together. at the Pond Cove level, we had to put on auctions and sell parents items and raise the money independently. One of the environments you talked about, the money came from that, for that opportunity through foundations and outside kind of, and it just seems like we shouldn't be light years behind Thornton Academy, maybe, at least at this level, or certainly not behind Gorham. And is it a matter of funds, or is it a matter that money's been spent different times, different years, and different budgets, but it's all, we got some Macintoshes over here that are made be outdated, and some Apples over here that are outdated. You walk around the buildings and you see computer hardware sitting around, nobody's using it, and it's out of date. So I would say if it's important enough to go outside to get professional help to buy an intercom system or a phone system, that certainly some thought may be put forth to get some expertise in what it is that, you know, you put the vision together on what it is you want, but get some outside expertise on the hardware and the software, because we're spending thousands of dollars in software as well, and what's the vision on the software?
No, you're perfectly correct. We are really in the process of doing that. I mean, this winter we talked with the folks at Harper Computers about how we can link some of this together, and we are in the process of really assembling that kind of a plan, because we quite agree with you. And in fact, I think the office is finally has a plan, and we have in the budget a proposal to buy the hardware that will allow us to work together on a network. I think that in the classroom and the library, how those are interrelated is also an important question. And we are concerned that any purchases we make be of equipment that is very much networkable. Networks cost money too. And once you get a network, you really need a computer to run that network. So you have to dedicate a computer to some degree to be the network server. Yeah. But there are any number of people available that we are in conversation with or plan to talk with about that kind of thing. And we are, I think, sufficiently alert to the problems and to the possibilities that we intend to make sure we not do anything without having a good plan for the future as well as current needs. Most of our computers were bought, with the exception of a single computer here or there in the last 3 years, we have not really bought any computers. We bought some in graphic arts and drafting, CAD systems, and one or two in other departments. But we really have made no substantial purchases of numbers of computers. What we're dealing with is Apples at a time when they were not commonly networked, nor was the network apparatus available. And in fact, starting, the September issue of Scientific American was all on computers, and three or four of the articles were on networks. That really is the new technology that is going to make mainframes obsolete. So that's really a complicated question.
Yeah, we certainly ought to, and I think Connie's hand was up next, but certainly whatever we do, we have to do in the context of some 4 or 5 year plan system-wide.
Yes, I've been through this process, and my impression when I came to the system last year was that the system had was simply unaware of some of the things that have been going on in other school districts, and I think that is not uncommon. A decision was obviously made to set up the middle school lab and to meet the proficiency requirements that were driven by the Reform Act of 84, I guess it was. And unfortunately, with the state of art being what it is, that it looked to me like that purchase had been made just about at the tag end of when those were truly useful machines, and that approach was a useful approach. It's not the only school system that's been left with a few dinosaurs around. What is a much harder issue for schools is to have staff, and I think Frank alluded to this in his request, it is very, very difficult to convince teachers that computers are in fact tools. I really approve of the way in which he's going at this, in the sense of when you have some kind of person driving describing this, like Joyce in the library, who truly sees the possibilities, then interesting things happen. If in fact the school board makes a decision to back buying equipment and staff is really tentative about it, you have another set, you have enough money to bring in the experts and set up a good system, you have a shot at making some changes. But frankly, I've listened to a lot of experts over the years on computers, and there's a lot of ambivalence about just what ought to happen with kids in computers, and there's no absolute best system and no best approach that you can go out there and be absolutely certain you've got the right way. I also noticed in the community dialogues and some of the discussions that I've had with people along the way, a fair amount of ambivalence in this community. There are a lot of people who are professionals or who are professorial types of one kind or another who are rather skeptical of technology, who believe that the disciplined mind is, in fact, what we have the business of dealing with in school first and foremost, and that technology may, in fact, take over too much of classroom time and attention. Obviously, I wouldn't want to put words in people's mouths, but we had some feedback from some of those discussions that made it clear to me, at least in looking at it as a generalized thing, that it wasn't an absolute clear consensus from our own parent community. What I think where we're at, though, is that in this budget, I was very interested to see the pieces where this needs service, because it certainly looks like a big need to me. And we need a lot of good planning. We have parents in the community, and if anybody's listening to this, those of you who've already identified yourselves, give me another call, or I have a list anyway, and I'll get in touch with you. I think the time is coming when we need to put together a task force. We clearly have people in this community with expertise we would like to tap, but the board needs to be aware of what those things are, how we can chart that out, and I can tell you right now, it's not easy. It takes time. It takes commitment. It takes the staff as well as the board, and there are no real easy answers. I just think it's a fascinating field, though, and one we absolutely have to deal with.
Good. Yeah.
I'm finished.
Well, I think we have to stop thinking about computers as just pieces of equipment. It's not like they're just Xerox machines. They are tools for learning. And I think one thing that we can do is incorporate discussion of how computers should be used in the curriculum committees. It really should be part of the discussion here, not just add-on features. And I'm afraid that's really the way that they've been seen up till now. And the other thing is, I think we've really got to make it part of a teacher proficiency standard that you can use the computer, that you're not phobic of the computer and too long the entire system, and not only the system, but you know, a lot of people have been afraid of computers. We just can't be afraid of computers anymore. It's got to be part of the standard.
Let me plug something in there if I can on that same thing. I think it's very important to help teachers obtain computers. And one way that some school districts have chosen to do it, that is something that maybe we had to consider, is letting teachers use the Apple or IBM educator purchase options to buy a computer of their own. But having the school district advance them the money up front in September and then letting them pay it off through a payroll savings plan, a payroll reduction plan, which works very well. A number of systems have done that and have been able to get a lot of teachers to have their own personal computers. And I think teachers need to begin to use them in their own thinking and planning as tools in order for them to use them in their own teaching in the classroom. And I know a number of systems where they've done this, and they really have great strides in terms of using the computer in their classroom. As soon as they begin to be comfortable with them, they really go after it. And that's just another way to think about it.
Well, I think it's the public section.
You'll get your chance. A couple of thoughts. I was involved in those sessions where we were getting the community involvement. And I agree with Connie. I think there was a certain amount of ambivalence, maybe even a little bit of anger, from people that thought there was too much emphasis on that. But I talked to some of those people. I think some of that was their jobs, or they had been related to people quite closely in some cases, where their jobs had been eliminated by computers. And so I think there's some feeling that might have been generated from that, that there was some anger about that, but that's just a little bit of feedback. But one of the things I wanted to mention is that there are companies like, and I'm not an IBM salesman by any stretch, but IBM does have a scholarship program that if we come up, and I'm sure Connie's probably familiar with that, maybe all of the big hardware companies do, but it certainly is something that we ought to look into. If we come up with X number of dollars, they basically, they're so intent in breaking into the education marketplace for their hardware that they're providing funds, matching funds, and sometimes it's a couple dollars for every dollar we come up with. So it could be a good opportunity. The other thing that I'm thinking about from when you're looking into this and you're talking about the need to put a piece of equipment in either a student's hands or a teacher's hands so they can take them home is the whole area of laptops. You know, they're now 386. You know, Peter gets to take his home. It'd be nice to have some of those available so when school's out, a teacher can take them home. I mean, they could use them at night to do whatever kind of work, or a student could use it. And it's also today available for students or teachers in from their homes through modems to link into the system at the school. So they don't necessarily even have to be at school to take advantage of all that's been purchased from a hardware standpoint and software standpoint. They can sometimes dial up from a seminar in Chicago and get information. So there's tons out there that we're not, and could make the whole system much more efficient. And I think a lot of when people get comfortable is when they've got them available and, you know, they can sit down and